Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Cassandra Albridge. I serve as the Vice President for College Advancement and Community Relations here at Macomb Community College. And it is my distinct honor to welcome the Macomb County Bar Foundation, our distinguished guests, and you to today's presentation. You are on Macomb Community College's Center campus in the beautiful Macomb Center for the Performing Arts. This 1,200-seat theater is currently in its 31st season of presentations, performances, entertainment, education, and enrichment for the people of Macomb County and Southeast Michigan. And I have the honor of welcoming you, but also letting you know that we are in a building that is also connected to the Lorenzo Cultural Center. In fact, today, just today, we are opening a very small exhibit called Boycott, which features a number of posters from boycotts, from historical and contemporary boycotts. So if you get a moment after today's presentation, please walk over to the Lorenzo Cultural Center and take a look at that exhibit. And then in March, we will actually have our larger exhibit, which is on the 1940s, from the war and beyond. So I hope that you will take advantage of that as well. On behalf of Macomb Community College, Jim Jacobs, the president of Macomb Community College, thank you so much for being here today. We welcome you and we hope you'll come back for more presentations. It is my honor to welcome Michael Warren, judge from Oakland County, who's going to kick off today's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Again, I am Judge Michael Warren. I'm an Oakland County Circuit Court judge, a former member of the State Board of Education, and a co-founder of Patriot Week, which has been promoting this event as well. We renew the spirit of America by celebrating our founding first principles from our Declaration of Independence, key documents and speeches, patriots that may they come alive in American flags from our history. I do have a little brochure if you're interested in other events that are like this. You'll love Patriot Week. First things first. If you are a veteran of any era, I want to give you my deepest appreciation for your service. I'm sure the audience shares the sentiment. All veterans, please rise for recognition. Thank you for your service. I want to thank everyone for attending today. There are a myriad of other places you could be, and choosing here, of course, was absolutely the best choice. This program was inspired by a similar project undertaken by the historynewsnetwork.org, and we recommend reviewing their website for additional information. They involved a number of prominent historians. We, however, are blessed with an all-star cast production. Our director, Steve Steinhardt, who we've worked tirelessly on this, is a Macomb County Community College adjunct professor and a director of the Macomb County Bar Foundation, which, of course, is involved in hosting today's event. The producer is Rick Troy, the executive director of the Macomb County Bar Association. Our fantastic cast includes Macomb County Sheriff Tony Wickersham, St. Clair Shores Police Chief Todd Woodcox, that's my old hometown, so I'm pleased to have him, Judge Carl Merlingua, Judge James Burnett, Judge Tony Viviano, Attorney David Green, Roseville City Treasurer Mickey Swaltowski, and Professor Doug Forrester. We are also blessed to be in this fine facility, secured by, you just heard her, the Vice President of the State Board of Education, she didn't tell you that, and Vice President for College of Advancement and Community Relations at Macomb County Community College, Dr. Cassandra Albridge, and her staff that has hosted this. Thank you all very much. This afternoon, we'll be conducting an imaginary trial of President Harry Truman. Charged with violating Article 6 of the Nuremberg Charter by ordering the dropping of atomic bombs on the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The trial is being held in 1947. On August 8th of 1945, the United States, France, the United Kingdom, and the Soviet Union created the International Military Tribunal for the just and prompt trial and punishment of major war criminals of the European Axis. Article 6 established three major crimes: crimes against peace, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. Article 8 of the Charter also stated that holding an official position was no defense to war crimes. Some facts to set the stage. In 1931, the Japanese army invades the Chinese province of Manchuria and installs a puppet regime. In 1937 through 1938, Japanese forces engage in the mass murder of civilians, most likely 200,000 people, in the Nanking Massacre, sometimes called the Rape of Nanking. On September 1st of 1939, World War II breaks out in Europe. In July of 1940, Japanese troops occupy the French colony of Indochina. The United States objects and responds by cutting off oil exports to Japan. On September 27th of 1940, Germany, Italy, and Japan create a military alliance called the Axis. Italy and others join the Axis as well. Over the next year, tensions between the United States and Japan heighten. On December 7th, 1941, Japan launches a surprise attack on the U.S. Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. U.S. losses are 2,330 troops killed and 1,140 wounded. The United States enters World War II on both the European and Pacific fronts. The United States joins the United Kingdom, the Soviet Union, and the remnants of the French Empire in opposing the Axis. Over the next year, Japan aggressively conquers territory throughout Asia. They even occupy some of the Alaskan Aleutian Islands. On June 4th through 5th of 1942, the United States fends off a Japanese naval attack at Midway Island, a major turning point in the war. Over the course of the next several years, the Americans pound the Japanese Navy and begin conquering Japanese-occupied islands. In March of 1945, American B-29s bomb Tokyo, burning half the city. 80,000 people die. U.S. forces invade Okinawa as the launching area for the invasion of main Japanese islands. Meanwhile, the United States undertakes a secret research project dubbed the Manhattan Project to produce the first atomic bombs. On July 16, 1945, the United States detonates the very first atomic bomb. The bomb generates power equal to 15,000 to 20,000 tons of TNT. Wikipedia, that great resource, actually does a fantastic job in summarizing the actual bombings and the aftermath. It states, on August 6, the U.S. dropped a uranium gun-type atomic bomb, Little Boy, on Hiroshima. American President Harry S. Truman called for Japan's surrender 16 hours later, warning them to, quote, expect a rain of ruin from the air, the like of which has never been seen on this earth, unquote. 3 days later, on August 9th, the U.S. drops a plutonium implosion-type device, Fat Man, on the city of Nagasaki. Within the first 2 to 4 months of the bombings, the acute effects of the atomic bombings killed 90,000 to 146,000 people in Hiroshima and 39,000 to 80,000 in Nagasaki. Roughly half of the deaths in each city occurred on the first day. During the following months, large numbers die from the effects of burns, radiation sickness, and other injuries compounded by illness and malnutrition. In both cities, most of the dead were civilians, although Hiroshima had a sizable military garrison. On August 15th, 6 days after the bombing of Nagasaki and the Soviet Union's declaration of war, Japan announced its surrender to the Allies. The trial we are about to undertake charges President Truman of criminal behavior for ordering the bombings. In the course of the war, approximately 298,000 American soldiers and civilians are killed, and 671,801 are wounded. Japanese casualties are enormous. 1.3 million soldiers killed, and another 672,000 civilians die. 4 million are wounded. You might ask yourself, why should we care about this history? Why does it matter today, what happened back in the 1940s? Thomas Jefferson would answer this way. By the way, he's quoted in my book, if anybody's interested. History, by apprising them of the past, will enable them to judge of the future. It will avail them of the experience of other times and other nations. It will qualify them to know ambition and designs of men. It will enable them to know ambition under every disguise it may assume, and knowing it, to defeat its views. In every government on earth, there is some trace of human weakness, some germ of corruption and degeneracy. Which cunning will discover and wickedness insensibly open, cultivate, and improve. Every government degenerates when trusted to the people alone. To the governed alone. The people themselves, therefore, its only safe depositories. And to render them safe, their minds must be improved to a certain degree. This indeed is not all that is necessary, though it is essentially necessary. The influence of government must be shared among the people. If every individual which composes the mass participants of the ultimate authority, the government will be safe. So knowing our history is vital to the self-governance and maintaining the blessings of freedom that we enjoy. Here we invite you to be part of this history by considering with an open mind the trial about to unfold. At the end of the trial, you will be invited to physically engage in our historical journey by filling out the verdict form found in the handout as well as the survey. Happy Veterans Day. God bless you. God bless America. Enjoy.
All rise. Calling the United Nations, First Harry S. Truman, the Honorable James M. Burnett presiding.
Good afternoon. Please be seated. Thank you. And please turn off your cell phones. Just a reminder, usually in the courtroom, we confiscate those things. I've had to confiscate my own cell phone on a number of occasions. Thank you for being here, and counsel, would you please place your respective appearances on the record and identify the persons at the table with you, if any.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. My name is David Grimm. I will be prosecuting this matter.
Good afternoon. My name is Carl Marlinga, and I'm proud and honored to represent the President of the United States, Harry S. Truman, who sits to my right.
Mr. Grimm, you may be seated momentarily, all right?
Certainly.
Just by way of background, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States is, in this instance, accused of war crimes, namely violations of the laws or customs of war. Such violations are included, but not limited to murder, ill treatment, or deportation to slave labor or for other purposes of civilian populations or of occupied territory, murder or ill treatment of prisoners of war or persons on the seas, killing of hostages, plunder of public or private property, wanton destruction of cities, towns, or villages, or devastation not justified by military necessity. You must remember, ladies and gentlemen, that a person accused of a crime is presumed innocent. This means that you must start with the presumption that the defendant is innocent. This presumption continues throughout the trial and entitles the defendant to a verdict of not guilty unless you are satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt that he is guilty. At the conclusion of this matter, you will be directed to a form of verdict, and I will explain that form of verdict at that time. Mr. Grimm, are you ready to make a brief opening statement?
Depends upon your definition of brief, Your Honor.
I knew you were going to say that. Try your best, Mr. Grimm.
I will do that. Ladies and gentlemen, what you see before you on the screen is the law with which President Truman has been charged with violating. And I want you to pay very close attention to the last few phrases of that law, and that is that destruction or willful damage to institutions dedicated to religion or education. I'm not sure that that's completely accurate, but what we're trying here today is the wanton destruction of cities, towns, or villages, or devastation not justified by military necessity. The key phrase is devastation not justified by military necessity. On August the 6th, that's 1945, President Truman threatened the Japanese with a rain of ruin from the air. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, that rain of ruin from the air had already taken place before the first atomic bomb was dropped on August 6th of 1945. In the 2 months leading up to August 6th of 1945, the American Air Force had destroyed 59 of the 66 largest cities in Japan. Over 1 million people had been killed. 20 million had been left without homes. So this reign of terror that the president threatened on August the 6th, it had already taken place, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. Again, 59 of the 66 largest cities in Japan had been destroyed. At the same time, American diplomats were telling President Truman that the Japanese were seeking to surrender on the terms demanded by President Truman, with just one exception, and that was that they would be allowed to keep their emperor, who was looked at as being a god. They were allowed to keep their emperor at least as a figurehead of their government. There was significant opposition in those days of July and August 1945 to dropping the atomic bombs by U.S. military leaders. And you might recognize a couple of these names. General Dwight D. Eisenhower was opposed to dropping the atomic bombs on Japan. General Douglas MacArthur was opposed to dropping the atomic bombs on Japan. And Truman's own chief of staff, his own military chief of staff, Admiral William Leahy, was opposed to dropping the atomic bombs on Japan. And in addition, a number of public figures were opposed to that action, as were the scientists, 69 of the scientists who developed the atomic bomb were opposed to using it against Japan, and they had the courage to sign a petition letting the president know of their opposition.
Mr. Grimm, you're at 4 minutes, thank you. You may continue.
God. We're going to get rid of a lot of paper here. Truman had spent $2 billion of taxpayers' money developing the atomic bomb. Japan provided the perfect opportunity to analyze and compare the real-world effects of uranium bombs and plutonium bombs. There was one of each. By measuring the aftermath of Ground Zero in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, future production of atomic bombs could be limited to whichever was most effective. Truman announced the bombing of Hiroshima while he was at sea, coming back from Potsdam, Germany on August 7th of 1945, the day after the first bomb was dropped. This is a quote from the New York Times. Truman said, "We have spent $2 billion on the greatest scientific gamble in history and won." These are the reasons I think the evidence will show that Truman dropped the bomb. It had little to do with the Japanese surrender. They were already ready to surrender. Dropping the bombs was protecting a $2 billion taxpayer investment while at the same time intimidating the Russians. Truman won his gamble. 140,000 innocent Japanese guinea pigs, mostly women and children, paid for Truman's gamble with their lives when those two bombs were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Thank you.
Mr. Marlinga, you're ready to proceed with a brief opening?
I am, Your Honor.
You may proceed.
Thank you. My client is charged with a violation of Article 6, namely that he approved the wanton destruction of cities, towns, or villages, or caused devastation not justified by a need in the military sense. My client is not guilty. I will remind this court and this jury that we have seen guilty verdicts in the past year, 1946, returned against the inhuman monsters who were truly guilty of such crimes. The Nazi criminals were convicted of waging a war of aggression and systematically murdering over 6 million Jews and other innocents. The criminals of the Japanese military command were likewise convicted of their crimes of using murder, torture, starvation, and rape as tactics of military aggression in China, and of using torture, starvation, and murder of prisoners of war in the Bataan Death March. And we cannot ever forgive or forget the perfidy of the sneak attack on Pearl Harbor, which saw 2,330 innocent troops murdered and another 1,140 maimed in the morning hours of December 7th, 1941, while Japan and the United States were still at peace. It is shocking that this innocent man, Harry S. Truman, should be required to face these baseless charges. We know what a war criminal is, and that appellation cannot be placed upon this man. The dropping of the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki were well justified by military necessity and motivated above all by Mr. Truman's desire to save lives and end suffering. The evidence will show that only as a result of his decision, this long and terrible war was brought to a quick end. The Japanese said that maybe they were ready to surrender, but the fact of the matter is, until these two bombs were dropped, there was no serious movement for surrender. Even after the first bomb was dropped, there was no serious movement for surrender. The evidence will show that if the United States had invaded Japan, as it would have had to have done if the surrender did not come, the Japanese military government was prepared to order the wholesale execution of 100,000 American POWs held captive in Japan. The order was already given when the invasion would begin. These POWs would have been murdered. The evidence will show that although there were severe casualties as a result of these two bombs, the number of deaths and total casualties would have been far greater if the United States had to invade the mainland. Although a land invasion of the mainland never happened because Japan surrendered, there is a way to estimate what the losses, both American and Japanese, would have been if the invasion had occurred. In the 82-day battle for Okinawa, a large island just off the mainland of Japan and a part of the nation of Japan, the United States saw 12,500 of its soldiers, sailors, and Marines die. Japanese dead were estimated at between 77,000 to 110,000, with total civilian dead and missing, in addition, being about another 150,000. This battle is the closest comparable that we have to predict what losses would have occurred if an invasion of the mainland took place. Since the mainland invasion was estimated to take 1 year, and the battle for Okinawa took about 3 months, the losses can be estimated at four times greater than what occurred on Okinawa. Basically, Okinawa was just an exact replica of what the mainland would be. This means that the total U.S. dead from an invasion would have exceeded 50,000, with other casualties in terms of the wounded. Total Japanese military deaths would have exceeded 500,000, plus about 600,000 civilians over and above that.
You're at 4 minutes, Mr. Melling.
Thank you. By dropping these bombs, it is likely that well over 1 million lives were spared, both American and Japanese. The cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were valid military targets. Hiroshima was the headquarters of the Japanese Second Army. Japanese was an industrial city manufacturing wet weapons to kill American soldiers. It was the duty of Harry S. Truman, as Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the United States, to take out as many military targets as possible to destroy Japan's capacity to wage war in order to save the lives of his soldiers. That is the duty of a commander. Harry S. Truman fulfilled that duty to the men and women who served under him. As a foreseeable consequence of his actions, he also happened to save the lives of hundreds of thousands of Japanese soldiers, sailors, and civilians. He is truly not guilty of any crime. In fact, his decision probably saved more lives than any decision in the history of the world before or after. Thank you.
Mr. Grimm, are you ready to call your first witness?
Yes, Your Honor, we would call Dr. Hachea to the stand.
Dr. Hachea, please be seated here in the witness chair. You may proceed, Mr. Grimm.
Witness, would you give us your full name for the record?
My given name is Todd Woodcox. When I was born in the United States many years ago, I moved to Japan and changed my name to Mashika Hashia.
In August of 1945, witness, did you have occasion to visit the cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki for the purpose of giving medical assistance after atomic bombs had been dropped on those cities?
Yes, I did.
Could you describe for the jury what you saw when you visited these two cities?
Describing in words could be very difficult. It's often been said a picture can make up for 1,000 words. I did prepare a video that could more easily display the destruction of the barbaric act that I have seen.
The film, did that accurately depict what you saw in Hiroshima and Nagasaki?
Except for the fact that it is black and white, yes, it does.
And that is the film that we are now viewing at this moment?
Yes.
And I would move the film into evidence.
No objection.
Then...
it is admitted. You may proceed.
Thank you.
Because of time constraints, witness, I have several other questions that I'd like to ask you while the film is playing. In Nagasaki, did you have an opportunity to determine how many military targets had been destroyed by the bomb?
In Nagasaki, there were four.
Four?
Military targets.
And while touring the city of Nagasaki, did you determine how many holy buildings, how many hospitals, and how many schools were destroyed by the atomic bomb?
In total, 21.
Let's talk about Hiroshima for a moment. Could you tell us how many immediate casualties there were as a result of the bomb?
From the initial impact and explosion, approximately 80,000 dead immediately.
And of those 80,000, how many were military personnel?
10,000.
So 7 out of 8, every 8 casualties was a civilian, correct?
That is correct.
Did women and children make up the larger number of those 70,000 casualties?
Without a doubt.
The doctors, tell us how many doctors were casualties of the bomb in Hiroshima.
There were approximately 298 doctors in Hiroshima on the day of the attack. 270 of them were killed.
And you've testified that a number...
May I correct my testimony?
Sure.
Killed or injured so severely that they could not perform any medical duties. Not all 270 were killed.
You indicated a number of schools that were destroyed. I want to call your attention to Shuriolana Primary School. That's a school for elementary children. What were the what happened to the children and the teachers of that school?
1,500 children were slaughtered, and I believe it was 37 teachers.
Let's move to Nagasaki. How many people were immediately killed as a result of the bomb on August the 9th, 1945?
40,000.
How many of the 40,000 people were military casualties?
150.
150 out of 40,000 casualties were military personnel, correct?
That is correct.
Nagasaki had the largest population of Catholics in Japan. Do you know how many Catholics were killed by the bomb?
10,000 Catholics were killed.
My math skills aren't very good, but if there were 150 military casualties and 10,000 Catholics killed, I think that means for every soldier that was killed, 67 Catholic innocents died. Is that correct?
Your math is correct, sir.
And I believe you've already told us there were only 4 military targets and that were 21 holy places, churches, and schools were destroyed, correct?
That is correct, sir.
And if you would, I believe you brought with you today a map, is that correct?
Yes, I did.
I'd move the introduction. The map is of Nagasaki, and the map depicts the damage to Nagasaki shortly after the bomb, the atomic bomb, correct?
That is correct.
And if we could have that, Council, any
objection? No objection.
All right. Before us is the map of Nagasaki, which the yellow circles. The towards the center, there's a red, small red circle. Is that the point of impact of the bomb?
Not necessarily the point of impact. The bomb actually exploded in the air, so it did not impact. It was detonated in the air. That would show a point on a map where it detonated above that
directly
area.
Directly below the bomb. And the various... targets that you've described in your testimony, they're all depicted on that map, is that correct?
Yes, they are.
Your witness, counsel.
Thank you. First of all, I want to confirm a couple of things with you. You said that there were 4 military targets, but in terms of the importance, let's talk about that. one of the military targets where the Mitsubishi works, is that correct?
I believe two of them were Mitsubishi factories.
Mitsubishi, the maker of the Japanese Zeros that were used in the sneak attack in Pearl Harbor, correct?
Zeros were used in that attack, yes.
Okay. So anyway, Nagasaki is the place where those were manufactured. With regard to Hiroshima, isn't it true that Hiroshima was a military base? I'll tell you what. I'm going to give you... You wrote a diary about your experiences, and I have a copy of it here. I'm going to hand you some things that you wrote in that diary, if I may approach the witness, Your Honor.
You may.
Could you please read from page 25 about your description of Hiroshima?
One thing is certain. Hiroshima was destroyed, and with it the army that had been quartered in Hiroshima. Gone were quarters, gone the command post of the 2nd General Army and the military school for young people, the general headquarters for the Western Command, the Corps of Engineers, and the Army Hospital. Gone was the hope of Japan. The war was lost. No more help would come from the God.
Okay, thank you. And also, you talked about this as a barbaric act. Isn't it true, sir, that it was only a barbaric act in your mind because it happened in Japan, and that if it had happened in the United States, you would have rejoiced in it?
Personally, no. I'm a doctor.
I want you to read.
I like people to live.
I want you to read from page 49 of your diary. It's a long passage, but I want this jury to understand the way that the news of these atom bombs were greeted in Japan. Please read from page 49.
Following the news that Nagasaki had been bombed, a man in from Fushu with the incredible story that Japan had the same mysterious weapon, but until now had kept it a strict secret and had not used it because it was judged too horrible even to mention. This man went on to say that a special attack squad from the Navy had now used the bomb on the mainland of America, and that his news had come from no less a source than General Headquarters. The blow had been dealt by a squadron of 6-engined trans-Pacific bombers, two of which failed to return. These bombs were assumed to have dived right into their targets to make certain of success. If San Francisco, San Diego, and Los Angeles had been hit like Hiroshima, what chaos there must be in those cities. At last, Japan was retaliating. The whole atmosphere in the ward changed. For the first time since Hiroshima was bombed, everyone became cheerful and bright. Those who had been hurt the most were the happiest. Jokes were made, and some began singing the victory song.
Okay, also, the attorney for the prosecution has suggested that the war was going to be nearing an end anyway. I want you to read from page 83 about the way that you and your fellow residents of Hiroshima took the news on August 15th that Japan had surrendered. Please read from page 83.
The hospital suddenly turned into an uproar, and there was nothing one could do. Many who had been strong advocates of peace and others who had lost their taste for war following the Pika were now shouting for the war to continue. The one word, surrender, had produced a greater shock than the bombing of our city. The more I thought, the more wretched and miserable I became.
Okay, two other things. I want to have you take a look at a couple of photographs. I want you to take a look at photograph number one, please. This happens to be from the attack on Pearl Harbor. You see there's billowing smoke without showing the gruesomeness of the actual injuries. Would you agree, sir, that if people are lit afire by burning oil, that can produce catastrophic injuries?
Yes, I would agree.
And would you also agree that in terms of whatever causes the injury to the individual victim, if your skin is burned off, it really doesn't matter if it comes from a bomb or from an atom bomb. Would you agree with that?
There are some minor differences, but in general, you are correct.
Okay, let's take a look at Exhibit 3, please. Now, we're not talking about hundreds of thousands, but these are three American soldiers, Marines actually, dead in the South Pacific. Sir, with regard to these individual lives, is there any difference between their deaths and any of the people who died in these two cities?
Death is death.
And so what you're complaining about is the number, correct?
I'm not complaining about anything, sir. I'm simply here to give testimony about what I saw.
Would you agree, then, that if we could find a way to end the war with the least possible loss of life, that that would be a preferred way to go?
That's not really my decision to make.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions.
You may step down, witness. Mr. Grimm, you may call your next witness.
Yes, Your Honor. We would call Michael Swatowski to the stand.
Very well. Mr. Swatowski. Here, sir. We have a special place for you here. Thank you. Your voice should be picked up fine. You may proceed.
Witness, would you please state your name for the record?
Michael Swatowski.
And what is your occupation?
I am a government official, an educator, and an expert on the closing days of World War II.
What happened, Mr. Swatowski, on August 6th of 1945 in the city of Hiroshima, Japan?
An atomic bomb was dropped on the city.
What was the number of immediate casualties?
About 90,000.
And how many of those casualties were military combatants?
About one in five.
And
say about 10,000.
About 10,000. And I'm not very strong on math, but if there were 80,000, that would be about one in eight were
one
military.
In eight, yes.
Thank you. How many hospitals were destroyed in Hiroshima on August 6th?
18 hospitals and about 32 clinics.
And what happened on August the 9th, 3 days later, in Nagasaki, Japan?
The city was hit by a second atomic bomb.
And the two cities were about similar population, were they not?
Yeah, Nagasaki was slightly smaller.
And what was the number of immediate deaths in Nagasaki, Japan, on August the 9th?
About 40,000.
And how many of those casualties were military combatants?
150.
I'm not going to ask you to do the math on that one, but...
Thank you.
That's a very, very infinitesimal fraction of the 40,000 deaths, correct?
Yes.
The did the U.S. make estimates of its own casualties in the event that it had to invade Japan?
Yes, there were a number of estimates made. U.S. Planners were planning on a November 1st invasion, November 1st of 1945, and they originally estimated about 45,000 casualties. And over the years, this number grew. The more controversial the decision to drop the bomb became, the more the estimate grew.
And I see that we've got an exhibit on the board right now in that regard. And looking at the top of what's on the board, the earliest estimates, the pre-Hiroshima military estimates, this is by the U.S. military, of the number of casualties is what?
You'll see it up there, 20 to 46,000.
And in a Truman radio address to the citizens of the United States on August 9th, 1945, what estimate did Mr. Truman give?
He used the word thousands.
And in the Truman memoirs, which were published in 1955, what was Mr. Truman's estimate of the number of American troops that might have been lost if there had been a land invasion of Japan?
10 years later, the estimate had grown to 1 million.
During that 10 years, was there a significant amount of criticism throughout the world and in the United States also concerning the dropping of the atom bombs?
Yes, the implications of the bomb and the emerging Cold War had made people start to question the dropping, and the estimates of the dead rose.
They rose rather significantly, did they not, from an estimate of 20 to 46,000, and then over 10 years with criticism, they grew to 1 million?
Quite a remarkable increase.
When was the order by President Truman to drop the bombs given?
This was right at Potsdam on July 25th, 1945. The president gave the order, and there was no second order. He signed an order that authorized the dropping of atomic bombs as they became available. And this gave the military complete autonomy to decide on the timing and location of the bombs, and really left no way to adjust for emerging, changing conditions.
Now, out of Potsdam, there came something called the Potsdam ultimatum, did it
yes.
not? And that ultimatum was an ultimatum to Japan to surrender or else, correct?
Yes.
And was the date of the Potsdam ultimatum July 26th of 1945?
Yes, it was.
So we're giving the Japanese an ultimatum on July 26th to surrender or else, but the day before, our president is telling the military to go ahead and drop the bomb before the ultimatum is ever delivered to the Japanese. Is that correct?
That's true.
The last several months before the bombs were dropped, what was the status of the American Air Force as opposed to the Japanese Air Force?
We had air superiority. Our Japan was really a defeated nation. The Air Force had destroyed 59 out of 66 of Japan's largest cities. Over 1 million people had been killed. There were 20 million left without homes. The Japanese Navy was confined to port, had no fuel. So their Air Force was basically grounded, and their Army was in retreat.
Pardon my analogy. You should never use a football analogy when you live in Detroit, Michigan.
Very bad, very bad.
But if this was a football game and the Japanese Army and Air Force were on their last leg before we dropped the atom bomb, dropping the atom bomb would have gotten a penalty flag for piling on, would it have not?
Yeah, it's almost like we're up 45 to nothing. Although we had suffered losses earlier in the war, let's say we had a huge lead and we're driving for yet another touchdown. So you could look at it that way, that what more do you need to do to win the game?
Was there any opposition in the United States to dropping the atom bombs?
There was.
And could you give us a couple of examples?
Well, the military was opposed, and I think we have a document here, an exhibit that shows a couple of quotes from a couple of very significant leaders. Of course, Eisenhower, Leahy, and MacArthur were opposed, but it's instructive to read the words of later President Eisenhower.
Would you please?
Yes. And I voiced my grave misgivings to Secretary of War Stimson, first on the basis of my belief that Japan was already a defeated and dropping that bomb was completely unnecessary. And secondly, because I thought that our country should avoid shocking world opinion by the use of a weapon whose employment was, I thought, no longer mandatory as a measure to save American lives. It was my belief that Japan was at that very moment seeking some way to surrender with a minimum loss of face. Secretary Stimson was deeply perturbed by my attitude.
And you also mentioned, I believe, Admiral Leahy, who was the military chief of staff under President Truman?
Yes. And I think we also, right below that document, that same document, if you page down, you would see his quote, but I'll read that. It is my opinion that the use of this barbarous weapon at Hiroshima and Nagasaki was of no material assistance in our war against Japan. The Japanese were already defeated and ready to surrender because of the effective sea blockade and the successful bombing with conventional weapons. The lethal possibilities of atomic warfare in the future are frightening. My own feeling was that in being the first to use it, we had adopted an ethical standard common to the barbarians of the Dark Ages. I was not taught to make war in that fashion, and wars cannot be won by destroying women and children.
President Truman has claimed that he dropped the bomb because it saved lives and ended the war. Did the bomb end the war and save lives?
I would say no. My research into the historical record shows that the Japanese surrendered because of the atomic bombs and the Soviet Union joining the war against Japan. We bombed Hiroshima on August 6th, the Soviets declared war on August 8th, and we bombed Nagasaki on August 9th. The Japanese surrendered on August 10th. The historical record demonstrates that the Japanese were almost certain to surrender before the U.S. planned invasion for November 1st, almost 2 months later. If we had continued with the successful conventional war, coupled with the devastating Soviet invasion of Manchuria, this was the judgment of our military leaders, and it was the consensus of Japanese thinking within their government. The Japanese had hoped that the Soviets would stay neutral and help them negotiate a surrender.
I hate to interrupt, but you're at the end of your time. You understand that.
I have one last question, if I could, Your Honor.
You may proceed.
Witness, you indicated that the bomb that dropped on Hiroshima happened on August the 6th, correct?
Yes.
You indicated that the Russians invaded Manchuria on August the 8th, correct?
Yes, August the 9th, actually.
Of 1945.
Yeah, it's like at midnight, a minute after midnight, they declare war on the 8th, so you could say, yeah, they've begun war, and then an hour later, they're invading, yes.
Now, President Truman, in his own writings, had indicated to other people, that when the Russians entered the war would be over. Do you recall those writings?
Yes, and that was the same feeling within the Japanese inner circle, that they were counting on the Russians to stay neutral. They had a treaty with them, and once they're by themselves, it's the U.S. that's already killing them, and now throw the Russians in too, your football analogy would be similar. Now they had no chance whatsoever.
And despite, last question, and despite the Russians entering the war on August 8th or 1 minute after midnight, the United States still went ahead and dropped the bomb on Nagasaki on August the 9th, correct?
That was Truman's mistake. He should have waited one more day. The Soviets had invaded. That was a big game changer. He could have waited one more day, and they would have surrendered, most likely. That's what the debate was, and we could have avoided 80,000 deaths in Nagasaki.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Marlingham.
To use a football analogy, aren't you engaging in Monday morning quarterbacking? In other words, because you know things after the fact, you assume that everybody would know the same things before the fact.
Yes, that is what this is. This is a trial after the fact to determine what decision should he have made.
Okay, you say that Japan was already defeated and was ready to surrender. You are aware, sir, as an expert, that Japan still had an army that numbered 5 million men in arms at the time of the surrender. Do you know that?
Yes, and I know the quotes from Eisenhower and Leahy saying that they were defeated and ready to surrender.
You also, heard the one witness who was the doctor who, after witnessing all of the terrible things that he witnessed at Hiroshima, still, when he heard that there was a surrender, said, "The one word surrender had produced a greater shock than the bombing of our city. The more I thought, the more wretched and miserable I became." Isn't that the typical reaction of most people in Japan at the time?
I would not know, but I wouldn't think that was unusual.
As we neared the end of the war in 1945 in the spring and then into the summer, isn't it true that the fighting became more maniacal?
Yes.
In fact, you are aware of the term kamikaze, are you not?
Yes.
Where suicide pilots would crash their planes into aircraft carriers to produce the maximum amount of death possible. You're aware of that as well.
Yes, and perversely, it shows you that killing civilians, bombing cities, even atomic bombing of cities, didn't have the effect that we were hoping for. They were ready to endure that because of that same maniacal attitude.
And again, you say that Japan was already defeated and ready to surrender. If they were so defeated and ready to surrender, then I would assume that sometime on August 6th, there would have been peace feelers that were put out to try to reach a peace accord. Would you not assume the same thing if they were already defeated and ready to surrender?
That's the perverse thing about it, is they had lost 59 cities already. Would number 60 be one that they say, "Oh, we can't endure"? You've got number 60 now. It was just more of the same. It didn't have the effect we thought it would.
And on August 7th, they did not surrender either if they were already defeated and ready to surrender, did they?
No.
And on August 8th, they weren't so defeated that they were ready to surrender, were they?
At 11 p.m., when the Russians declared war, the Soviets declared war, that took the credibility away from the people saying, "Don't surrender." And then the real discussion began.
But
the internal staff had, after Hiroshima, they hadn't even called a meeting. They didn't call a meeting till the Russians invaded, then they called a meeting.
And that's the point. How would Harry S. Truman, the President of the United States, know what the Imperial staff was talking about? He had no indication on August 6th, 7th, or 8th that anything was coming in the way of peace, did he?
From his own memoirs, he thought once the Russians entered, he was brilliant to get them to enter, the game was over for the Japanese, and he knew that he had them then. There was no possible way for them to win.
And so you think that the Soviets entering the war was the key factor and not the dropping of the second bomb?
Well, in terms of what happened, all three things happened, two bombs and the invasion. So we know that produced surrender on the 10th.
Okay.
But, you know, if you took away the two bombs, the historical record indicates we had a pretty good chance for surrender right there.
You heard
my... Should have waited one day.
You heard my opening statement where I talked about the dead on Okinawa, both U.S. And Japanese deaths.
Yes.
Do you agree with me that all lives matter, whether they're Japanese or American?
Absolutely.
Do you have any doubt that if the United States had invaded Japan, that the casualties, whatever the number would have been, and of course nobody knows in advance because it didn't happen, but the numbers would have been horrific. Do you agree with that?
The way you have to think of that is, okay, if we invade 2 months later, November 1st, there's going to be big casualties. But really what I'm saying is, if you wait one day, in the month of August in 1945 in the Pacific sector, we were averaging 7 casualties a day. There's no land forces fighting. So for the chance that 7 people might die, and they might not die, that's an average. You might have no one die, or people might die in a car accident. You know, that's going to happen whether you bomb or not. If you wait that one day, take a chance on those 7 deaths, you can save 100,000 people, that's worth a wait.
Yeah, so as the commander of a group of people or as the commander of chief of the armed forces of the United States, you think it would be better to have lost a few thousand or 10,000 or 100,000 more and take the chance that peace could come about?
Well, I'm saying wait one day, take a chance that you might not lose those 7 people that you're averaging, and see if the Russian invasion and us destroying 60 of their biggest cities is enough to make them quit.
Okay, last question then. You're saying waiting one day. But UI, as you sit on that stand, can't say definitively if it was the second bomb or if it was the Russians that caused the Japanese to surrender. Not quoting what Mr. Truman said, but could you possibly know what was the largest factor?
You can take a pretty good guess reading what the Japanese are saying amongst themselves. And it seems like the biggest factor for them is we can't possibly win anymore.
And
they endured the bombing of the cities. They'd endured the bombing of 60 other cities.
And again, as far as what Harry S. Truman, the president, would know, there was silence from Japan on August 6th, 7th, and 8th, so that he was totally in the dark as to what these discussions would have been.
Well, there were, you know, I don't...
Give me chapter and verse, what discussion, who called Washington, who sent a teletype to Washington, who said we want to talk peace now on August 6th, 7th, or 8th. Anybody?
No, they didn't even
call
a meeting. Okay,
thank you.
You may step down, witness. Thank you. Mr. Marlinga, you may call your first witness.
I call President Harry S. Truman.
Sir, please be seated in the witness chair. We're skipping that. You may proceed.
Would you state your name again for the court and the members of the jury?
Harry Truman.
Tell us, Mr. Truman, why is it that you authorized the dropping of these bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki?
To bring the war to an end as quickly as possible.
Right.
With the least number of casualties that we could.
Thank you. Basically, I want you here to have answered that question, and now I'll leave you to cross-examination. Mr. Grimm.
Mr. President, you ordered the nuclear strike on Hiroshima on July 25th of 1945, is that correct?
I don't think that's correct. Basically, I'm not sure if it was July 25th. Excuse me, I got a...
I have a timeline here, if I could ask the deputy to present it to the witness, if you have no objection, Mr. Grimm.
No objections whatsoever.
Yeah. There's another page. Thank you. All right, what was your question?
I believe that you ordered the nuclear strike on Hiroshima You gave that order on July 25th of 1945.
No, the military, along with my approval, felt that the use of the bomb should be made as soon as they were ready. The target was not picked out.
The Potsdam ultimatum, when you met with Churchill and Stalin, the Potsdam ultimatum to the Japanese, that wasn't made known to the Japanese until July 26th of 1945, correct?
Yes, it's called the Potsdam Declaration, and it was published on July 26th.
During an interview after the bombs were dropped, did you not state that one of the main objectives of the Potsdam Conference was to get Russia in as quickly as we could, and then to keep Russia out of Japan, and that you, in fact, accomplished that? Is that correct?
I really don't recall. You have to tell me what interview you're talking about. I don't recall that.
Let me move on, Mr. President. On July 18th of 1945, you made an entry into your diary which stated, and I quote, "Believe Japs will fold up before Russia comes in." Do you recall making that entry into your diary?
Yes, that was a guess, just like a lot of the testimony of Mr. Sutolsky was guesses. That was a guess. We didn't know what would happen.
Of course, Mr. Sutolsky's testimony was an educated guess based upon history. Would you not agree?
But guesses, nevertheless. We were engaged in a war we did not start, a war that would have taken our society and destroyed it unless we reacted, and we had to react to that war.
There was a lot of talk, sir, by your attorney of the number of casualties at Pearl Harbor. And I believe the number was something over 2,000, just over 2,000.
Killed.
Killed, correct. All of those 2,000 casualties were military combatants, were they not, Mr. President?
Of course. Certainly they were.
But
we had also been through 2.5 years of driving the Japanese out of the various Pacific islands, and there were several hundreds of thousands of civilian casualties in those islands.
And we know, sir, that with the bombing of Nagasaki, there were 40,000 casualties, and only 150 of those 40,000 people were military combatants. Correct, sir?
Correct. Of course, we did not know that at the time. We knew that the Japanese were embedding their military within the civilian population, but the exact numbers we didn't know.
You had several options available other than dropping the atomic bomb. For one, the United States had already destroyed 59 of Japan's 66 largest cities. You could have ordered a continuation of conventional aerial attacks. And the big difference between conventional aerial attacks and dropping an atomic bomb is that with conventional aerial attacks, the targets are narrowed to military targets, and you don't have 40,000 women and children going up in smoke. Would that be accurate, Mr.
No,
President?
That's not accurate. The bombing of Tokyo was conventional bombing, and there was 150,000 civilian casualties in that bombing that was done prior to this.
You're aware that the naval blockade of Japan was literally starving not just the Japanese army, but the people of Japan. And the people of Japan had not had white rice to eat for over a year prior to the dropping of the first atomic bomb. Are you aware of that, sir?
Yes, we're also aware of the fact that the Japanese fought with fanatical determination. And they actually, we had just been through in Okinawa, a battle that lasted 82 days, that they fought to the last person in the suicide bombing with the kamikazes. We were aware that the Japanese were determined fighters and that they would go to the last person if that was what their orders were.
Sir, the first atomic bomb was dropped on August the 6th, 1945.
That's correct.
And we know that the Russians, after Potsdam, you were aware that the Russians were going to invade Manchuria and Japan on August the 15th, 1945, correct?
I'm not sure that I was aware of that, but I knew they were coming, they were going to do that.
All right. And did the thought ever cross your mind to wait 9 days? 9 days, there would be no U.S. military losses. The Russians would come in 9 days and see what impact that had on the Japanese and their decision to surrender. Did that thought cross your mind?
No, it didn't. We were preparing, and when I say we, the military was preparing for an invasion of Japan. The dropping of the two bombs was a preparation for that invasion, and of course, in the hope that they would surrender and make that invasion not necessary. But that was part of the whole preparation so that we would not lose the tremendous casualties that we suffered throughout the Pacific in the last 2-3 years.
On August the 7th, sir, 1945, while you were on a ship returning to the United States from Potsdam, Germany, the New York Times reported that, and this is a quote from you, "We have spent $2 million on the greatest scientific gamble in history and won." Do you recall that quote, sir?
No, I don't recall that quote. But that when you say $2 million or $2 billion, I forget what you said. It was a gamble. We didn't know what would happen on that particular matter. And the fact that we had the Japanese surrender, it did come out to be a successful endeavor. Without, I might say, the casualties on the American side. So it was a successful endeavor. That was my thought. It's still my thought today. I still think it was a successful endeavor.
The two bombs, that one was uranium, the other was plutonium. Japan provided a perfect opportunity to compare the two bombs by dropping one on Hiroshima and the other on Nagasaki and measuring which bomb was most effective. That would be accurate, would it not?
I don't think that was even in anybody's thinking at that time.
You're near
they dropped a bomb on Hiroshima, then on Nagasaki, and we did not have another one, but we were trying to get one as soon as possible by the end of August, so that if there wasn't a surrender, then I would assume that a third bomb would have dropped.
Mr. Grimm, start wrapping it up.
I will. If the bomb dropped on Hiroshima was uranium and the bomb dropped on Nagasaki was plutonium, it was a way to determine, the cities were almost the same size, it was a way to determine which bomb was more effective. Would you not agree with that?
I don't agree that that was in our thinking. No, I mean, maybe it might be. I can't imagine. I'm not a scientist. I don't know. I was the President of the United States with the responsibility of the people of this country, and I knew that we were had suffered severe casualties in a war that we did not start, and so therefore we were trying to end that war as quickly as possible.
If that was in the mind of the scientists, Mr. President, which bomb, plutonium or uranium, would be most effective? The number of Japanese guinea pigs that lost their lives.
Objection, Your Honor. This has been asked and answered several times. I'll formalize it, Your Honor. I object to the term guinea pigs. That is slanderous and highly inappropriate, and I ask that be stricken from the record.
This is cross-examination. However, Mr. Grimm, I would suggest you rephrase that question so it's properly before the court.
Certainly. Did the thought that in finding out which bomb was more effective, did the thought that hundreds of thousands of Japanese lives would be lost in coming to that determination, did that ever cross anybody's mind?
Well, when you ask me that, I don't know what's in everybody's mind. It certainly didn't incur, it didn't cross my mind. We were in a war. We were in a fighting war. Americans were dying in that war. We wanted to bring it to a conclusion. And this was a means to bring it to a conclusion with the least casualties possible. And that's what I did. That's why I made a decision, and I would make it again.
One last question, Mr. President. Would it be accurate that the buck does stop right here?
Yes, that would be accurate.
Thank you.
And thank you for that question.
You may step down, Mr. President. You may call your next witness.
The defense calls Douglas Forrester.
Mr. Forrester, please be seated.
Sir, your name for the court, please.
Douglas Forrester.
Tell us what your expertise is in, please.
Historical testimony for the defense.
Okay. First of all, tell us, was Hiroshima a valid military target?
It was.
Why is that?
The conventional bombing throughout the World War II had an impact on both military and civilian targets and victims. This particular bomb, because of its unique impact, would have a greater way of explaining to the people what the real problem is. The bomb was intended to shock the leadership of the Japanese government to recognize that this war is going to be prosecuted to the utmost effect until the Japanese were ready to resign to a complete surrender to the Potsdam.
Okay. And also, Hiroshima was home to the Japanese Second Army, is that correct?
That is correct.
And that was going to be charged with the defense of the mainland of Japan, the southern and western regions, if a land invasion had occurred, is that correct?
That is correct. And it was also the only location of the bomb sites that were selected that did not have American POWs
I'll get to the American POWs in a second. Was Nagasaki a valid military target?
Nagasaki was a valid military target.
We've talked about the fact that there were deaths of civilians. Could you comment upon that?
Civilian deaths will always be an effect of a war when you're dropping bombs in places where military are located and where defense plants are located. The people working in defense plants have to live somewhere.
All right. Did the Japanese have similar plans for bombing the United States?
They did. They actually had a target for the tank plant in Warren, Michigan was their number one target, if they could get there.
Okay. What did the Battle for Okinawa teach us about the willingness of Japan to surrender?
That the Japanese were willing to fight to the very end, to the last man and last woman, and that their own people were involved in not only making the weapons of war in Hiroshima, but they were also lined up after the proposed invasion of the mainland of China, of Japan. They were the ones who were to stand behind the enemy weapons with bricks and hand grenades to assist the army if they were overrun. They were mobilizing their people.
At the end of the war, I quoted a figure of about 5 million people in arms, military people, that Japan still had ready, willing, and able to fight. Is that correct?
It's correct.
The prosecution has talked about Japan being a defeated country, anxious to already defeated and ready to surrender. Do you think that characterization is accurate?
It's not an accurate characterization because the Japanese High Command, which ultimately was the Army and the Navy and 12 people at the very top, were making all the decisions. And even the Emperor himself was listening to what they said and making decisions as to whether they should end the war or not.
And one of the things you mentioned before about prisoners of war, it was important to end the war before the invasion of Japan took place. Isn't that correct?
It's correct. 100,000 prisoners of war were on the island of Japan and would immediately have been killed if the invasion had not succeeded.
As a matter of fact, I want to read you something. This was from the Japanese War Ministry, the standing orders. Quote, whether they are destroyed individually or in groups, or however it is done, with mass bombing, poisonous smoke, poisons, drowning, decapitation, or whatever, dispose of them as the situation dictates. In any case, it is the aim not to allow the escape of a single one, to annihilate them all and not leave any tracks. That was said about the prisoners of war, was it not?
Yes, it was.
And of course, that person who issued that command was indeed tried as a war criminal, was he not?
Yes, he was.
Okay.
I might mention that there's a difference yes. between trying military personnel and trying those who make the decisions at the outside as to who's vulnerable for the kinds of things that were listed in the initial three items of Nuremberg.
Okay. Now, you also heard my opening statement where I extrapolated from the losses on Okinawa to what the land invasion would have meant for Japan. I know that we're talking about an event that never happened, but do you think that was a fair extrapolation?
As extrapolations go, it was a fair one. Difficulty is that from April, at the time when Truman became president, until July, he had 3 months to learn everything he needed to know, having had no knowledge before of what was going on in the war. And decisions as to what the invasion might become and how large it was going to be kept increasing because we became increasingly more aware of the numbers of personnel that were on Japan and were engaging to defend.
Okay. From what you know, in your opinion, if the second bomb in Nagasaki had not been dropped, do you think that just the entry of the Russians into the war would have caused an immediate surrender?
No. In response to some of the things that were said by the other side, the most important thing about Nagasaki was that it was the one which convinced the emperor to decide to end the war. There was fighting in the high command of the Japanese leadership. Even 10 of 12 wanted to stop. The other two did not. And when the emperor stepped in, after Nagasaki, he said that the reason we did it was because of the second bomb.
Okay. And also, in closing, the last question, you heard the good doctor that testified, and you heard about the reaction that the Japanese had to surrender. Was that a fair reaction that seemed to apply all throughout Japan after the surrender?
Throughout Japan it did.
Yes. Okay. I have nothing further.
Mr. Grimm, you may cross-examine.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I know that both experts may have taken some liberties today. But
I can't help but ask you, just how was the Japanese military going to bomb a tank plant in the city of Warren, Michigan in 1945? Could you explain that for me, please?
That was, subsequent documents show that was the number one target on the list they had proposed in their wildest dreams if they could invade America.
And your testimony in that regard about there being danger to a tank plant in Warren, Michigan, that was in your wildest dreams?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well, I didn't understand your answer. I'll move on.
Okay.
You spent some amount of time, sir, talking about the targets. And again, at that time, I think there were seven of the top 66 cities in Japan were unscathed by bombings, and Hiroshima and Nagasaki were two of those seven, correct?
That's correct.
Mr. Marlinga asked you questions about the how these were important military targets. Sir, I'm going to ask you to explain how in Nagasaki, when 40,000 people were instantly obliterated by an atomic bomb, if it was a military target, how is it possible that only 150 military personnel were killed out of those 40,000?
Nagasaki was not the second choice. There were three other cities that would have been bombed rather than that one, except that the cloud cover that they had that day necessitated putting the bomb in a place where they could at least see clearly where they were doing it. So that the choice of the city was a very difficult one. However, it needs to be kept in mind that there were 100,000 POWs whose lives were being threatened, and the quicker the war was over, and with a greater impact on the Japanese leadership, the greater the chance of having our soldiers be recovered would be accomplished. And all of them virtually were recovered because it was such a quick decision.
So what you're telling us is, sir, that because there was cloud cover over three other Japanese cities.
Two.
The United States willy-nilly decided, let's drop an atomic bomb on Nagasaki and let's obliterate 40,000 women and children to send a message. Is that your testimony today, sir?
I'm reporting what I have with the facts, but the important thing to remember is that 40,000 women and children would be a small number compared to the numbers that were being annihilated other places, or that would have been involved later on if the land war had been put forward. There were over 100,000 Southern or South Korean women who were being used as brothel representatives, who were being raped on a regular basis. They wanted the war to end too. They would have been killed immediately if the war had not been won by the United States.
You know, if we're talking about wildest dreams, that sounds like maybe the wildest of the dreams.
Those are real numbers.
But let's go back, sir. Let's go back, sir. Is there any doubt in your mind that if the Russians weren't scheduled to invade until the 15th of August of 1945, correct?
That's correct.
And because we dropped the first atomic bomb on August 6th of 1945, the Russians on their own decided to invade on August the 8th, 1945. Would that be accurate?
That is accurate.
Thank you. The invasion of the Russians, I mean, that put us, That put the Japanese in a situation where it was them against the world, correct?
I won't say that. Okay. I think it's important to remember that the Russians entered the war on their own decision, not on the American decision, and that they were lining up along the border of Manchuria, not Japan. They wanted to invade Japan and take Japan for themselves. And having seen what was going on in Eastern Europe at the very same time, where they had moved entirely into East Germany and were occupying Berlin,
Race for the spoils, then, wasn't it? Thank you for that answer.
No, it's not spoils for occupation of territory, and the United States
gentlemen,
never had territorial.
Gentlemen, one at a time. We're trying to record this, and we can't do that unless you follow that simple rule. All right?
United States territorial objectives were zero.
We knew what happened in Germany when there was a battle going on between the United States and Russia for who would control what. The United States was afraid of the same type of situation involved in being coming about in Asia, correct?
Well, the Soviets weren't in Asia at the time.
Well, what do you call Manchuria? But anyways,
well,
anyways,
you'll have to start wrapping it up, Mr. Grimm.
Thank you.
You're out of time.
When the United States, and in particular President Truman, found out that the Russians had entered Manchuria in August the 8th, don't you think that moved up the timing of the second atomic bomb and wasn't that the reason why we dropped it on a defenseless city like Nagasaki because of cloud cover on other Japanese cities, correct?
As the Commander-in-Chief of the United States Military Forces, President Truman authorized on July 25th the dropping of the bomb by the military and decisions that they made. He didn't have any control over it until after the second bomb was dropped, or he chose not to until July 11th, when he asked that they not drop further bombs beyond the first two until they see what the response would be from the Japanese.
Well, we didn't have any bombs after the first two, but sir,
we were developing them.
We were developing them, yes, but we didn't. We only had two bombs at that time, correct?
Which might say that President Truman was not aware of that if he was asking them not to drop more bombs after the 11th.
Didn't President Truman abdicate his responsibility as commander-in-chief when he gave the U.S. military carte blanche to drop the bombs whenever they decided to drop them? Yes or no, sir? Yes or no?
No.
No.
The leader of a nation must trust people under his authority to do as they're commanded to do.
Yeah, that same defense was raised by the Nazis who were tried at the Nuremberg trials, sir. The very same defense.
Well, if you want to compare the Nazis to America,
have a good day, sir.
All right. You may step down. Thank you. Are you ready to proceed with the closing arguments? We're going to do it in this fashion. Each side will be allotted 10 minutes. The rebuttal, Mr. Grimm, you may, at your option, choose the amount of time allocated to rebuttal, but your argument and rebuttal argument is not to combined is not to exceed 10 minutes. Right?
Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay.
If we would, if we could put up at the same time, I'm hoping my time hasn't started running yet.
No,
If we could put up at the same time the Dwight Eisenhower statement and the Admiral William D. Leahy statement, please, on the screen. You've seen these two statements that were made by two of the most respected military leaders during World War II. One, of course, Dwight D. Eisenhower, later became a two-term president of the United States. But in addition to those two, General MacArthur, General Douglas MacArthur, who was maybe the best known of all of our generals in World War II, when asked about the decision to drop the bomb, General MacArthur answered that he had not been consulted by anyone. He went on to say he saw no military justification for dropping the bomb. The war might have ended weeks earlier, he said, if the United States had agreed, as it later did anyway, to the retention of the institution of the emperor. The only thing that was keeping the Japanese from surrendering before the atomic bombs, they were asking for one thing that Truman did not give them, and that was to keep their emperor, even if it was just as a figurehead. The ironic thing is, after he dropped the two atomic bombs, then he gave the Japanese what they wanted, and the emperor was allowed to remain. If he would done it in July, thousands and thousands and thousands of lives would have been saved. I quoted earlier President Truman on August the 7th of 1945 when he made the announcement, "We have spent $2 billion on the greatest scientific gamble in history and won." This is what they never got up there, did they? This is exactly what Admiral Leahy said about that decision. You saw his words earlier in this trial, and one of the leading U.S. physicists, after hearing that statement by Truman, Leo Szilard, said, "To put the atomic bomb in terms of having gambled $2 billion and having won offends my sense of proportions." And you know what? As Americans, it should offend all of us.
Mr. Marlinga.
Again, how easy it is to argue after the fact. Mr. Svitolsky says, "All we had to do is wait one more day." Mr. Grimm says, "Oh, surely with the Russians coming in, that would have ended the war. We didn't have to do anything more." But that's only history after you've lived through history. From the standpoint of Harry Truman on August 6th, 7th, 8th, or 9th, he didn't know that. He wouldn't know that. And it turns out that on August 15th, the emperor did finally go on radio and say, "Enough, we surrender." But Mr. Truman, would not have known that at the time. I mean, the United States might have had to have dropped a third bomb, a fourth bomb, a fifth bomb. The Russians may have had to have invaded Manchuria. The Russians may have had to invade northern Japan. The United States might have had to have invaded the south of Japan. On August 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th, all the way up to the 15th, the fact of the matter is that President Harry S. Truman did not know that. All he knew at the time was that the pace of the war, the pace of casualties were increasing. We didn't talk about Iwo Jima. Iwo Jima was one of the few places where American casualties exceeded Japanese casualties. But just take a look at Okinawa, because again, it is the good pattern for what would have happened. Sure, lives were lost. Approximately 100,000, more than 100,000 lives were lost in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But the total number of lives that Mr. Truman was looking at that were likely to be lost is a number that we will never know. But in terms of what he was experiencing as commander-in-chief, he knew that he had to do two things. First of all, destroy Japan's capacity to wage war. He had to save as many lives as possible. He knew that Hiroshima was the center of the Japanese defense for the South. He knew that Nagasaki was the maker not only of Zeros and other airplanes, but other war materials that were being turned out to kill Americans. It is beyond his capability to say that the Japanese should not have built the houses so close to the plants or to the barracks, but these were valid military targets, and in any war there is collateral damage. His purpose was not to kill civilians. The Nazi purposes, the Japanese military purposes were, as they proved time and time again, to kill civilians. Those were war criminals. This was a person who was trying to end the war and save suffering. We know from the doctor that we had here on the stand that the average citizen in Japan did not feel already defeated and ready to surrender. Remember, he said in his diary, after the surrender was announced on August 15th, the hospital suddenly turned into an uproar, and there was nothing one could do. Many who had been strong advocates of peace and others who had lost their taste for war following the Pika, that's the explosion, were now shouting for the war to continue. The one word surrender had produced a greater shock than the bombing of our city. The more I thought about it, the more wretched and miserable I became. This means that the very same fierce fighting that we saw on Okinawa, in Iwo Jima, the kamikaze attacks on the aircraft carriers, all of that would have been, if you extrapolate it, would have been only increased when American soldiers finally hit the mainland of Japan. Japanese citizens, as in Okinawa, would have been lined up to be mowed down as the first defense that the Japanese troops would use. 100,000 American POWs would have been killed. With all of that death and destruction as a virtual certainty, all we hear now from the prosecution is that, well, Japan was already defeated and ready to surrender. 5 million men in arms, fighting that grew more fierce with each passing day, was not any indication that Japan was already defeated and ready to surrender. Oh, sure, after the fact, you could say, well, look, let's take a look at some of the things that were said in the private councils of the Japanese military. That information was not available to Mr. Truman. Again, Mr. Truman had the obligation to save lives of the people for which he was the commander in chief. In the end, you know what it comes down to, the people who are now raising these issues, it's just a matter of whose ox is being gored, who is suffering the losses. Again, from the doctor's diary, he said, if San Francisco or San Diego and Los Angeles had been hit like Hiroshima, what chaos there must be in those cities. At last, Japan was retaliating. The whole atmosphere in the war changed, and for the first time since Hiroshima was bombed, everyone became cheerful and bright. Those who had been hurt the most were the happiest. Jokes were made, and some began singing the victory song. That does not sound like a nation that was already defeated and ready to surrender. In terms of what he had to do to save American lives, this man acted. Sure, some ivory tower intellectuals can wring their hands and say, oh, I don't know if I would have done that. But in the fog of war with people dying every day, he did what he had to do. And as a consequence, it not only saved American lives, which was his chief aim, but it also means that there are people who are alive today, both Japanese and Americans, by the hundreds of thousands, who would have been dead if Harry Truman did not act the way he did when he did. This man is not guilty. Again, as I said in my opening statement, his decision probably was the single decision in the history of the world that saved the most human lives. And all human lives matter. Japanese lives, American lives, men, women, children, boys. Yeah, I'll close with this. Those three boys that were on the beaches in the South, in the Pacific, those are no less human beings than anybody who lived in Hiroshima or Nagasaki. You call them combatants. Why? Because you draft them, you put a uniform on them, but you send them out, they're still human beings. You try to save every single human being that you can, because all lives ultimately matter. That's what he did. He is not guilty of anything. Thank you.
You may exercise rebuttal if you wish.
Thank you, Your Honor. One thing I'm certain of, when Mr. Marlinga was disparaging Ivy Tower intellectuals, he sure as hell wasn't talking about me. Collateral damage, Mr. Marlinga just used that term. We hear collateral damage. There's a target and several civilian lives are lost. Nagasaki, 40,000 lives were lost and only 150 of them were military personnel. That's not collateral damage, that's a war crime. The fact that, and I didn't know this till their expert got on the stand and testified to it, the fact that Nagasaki was the third choice on August 9th, and we still went ahead and bombed it, despite there was no military there. There was nothing of any military significance. Aren't you appalled by that? Aren't you appalled by that? That plane certainly could have turned around and gone back, but no, it didn't, because the Russians had invaded the day before and we needed to get in and show the Russians who's who and secure our territory. So we went ahead with the bombing anyways. Again, I've touched on this earlier, and I couldn't find the quote earlier, but I just did. When Truman on August the 7th said, "We have spent $2 billion on the greatest scientific gamble in history and won," I'm offended by that. I'm offended that hundreds of thousands of people had to die so he could win that gamble. Admiral Leahy, his own military chief of staff, said, "It was my reaction that the scientists and others wanted to make this test because of the vast sums that had been spent on the project." Truman knew that. That's his own chief of staff talking. Today you heard from four witnesses. I think after hearing this testimony, it's clear that the elements necessary for a violation of Article 6 have been established. They described the wanton destruction, and now I've got the wrong. They described the wanton destruction that is described in Article 6. They talked about the horrible things that happened in Nagasaki and Hiroshima, where people were turned into shadows that were burned into the streets and the walls of that city. And the percentage of school children was huge. You heard about the 115 students of the school in Hiroshima. Every one of them and their 39 teachers were vaporized. What crime did they commit? They didn't have anything to do with Pearl Harbor. And the fatalities at Pearl Harbor were not women and children. The fatalities at Pearl Harbor were military personnel. We don't do that. We're better than them. We don't kill women and children to win a war. We just don't do that. The evidence demonstrates when President Truman gave the order on July 25th of 1945, he was aware of the results of the testing in New Mexico. He had been given that information when he was in Potsdam, Germany, and he knew full well that if we dropped those atom bombs, what would result? And what would result was this horrible, horrible devastation. And we have heard today, especially as to Nagasaki, from all four witnesses, there was no military justification. And that's the test under the law, under Article 6. Was there military justification? They might be able to make an argument as to Hiroshima. They can't make an argument as to Nagasaki. And when you decide your verdicts today, you'll vote twice. The president is charged with two counts. The first as to Hiroshima, the second as to Nagasaki. And keep in mind, the buck does stop right here. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will collect your verdict form from the play that's contained within the playbill. I want to, at this time, review the form of verdict with you. You will note that the form of verdict contains two counts. Count one charges, or you'll have to decide as to whether you check the box not guilty or guilty. And the charge is of ordering the dropping that Harry Truman is not guilty or guilty of ordering the dropping of the atomic bomb as Commander-in-Chief of the United States on the city of Hiroshima, Japan, on August 6, 1945, killing civilians and causing devastation to property without justification or military necessity in violation of Article 6 of the Nuremberg Charter of the International Military Tribunal. So in respect to that charge, you, depending upon your decision, you either mark not guilty or guilty. Count two, again asks, is Harry Truman not guilty or guilty of ordering the dropping of the atomic bomb as Commander-in-Chief of the United States on the city of Nagasaki, Japan, on August 9, 1945, killing civilians and causing devastation to property without justification or military necessity in violation of Article 6 of the Nuremberg Charter of the International Military Tribunal. I want to thank you for your obvious patience and the attention you showed here. If you will please also, in addition to filling out the verdict form, fill out the survey on the reverse side of the verdict form. It will be most helpful if you do that. Again, thank you, and please, the form of verdicts will be collected and tabulated immediately following their being turned in. Thank you. Court is in recess at this time. Jury can deliberate. Thank you.
All rise.
Ladies and gentlemen, excuse me, we have a verdict. As to count one, that is the dropping of the atomic bomb as Commander-in-Chief of the United States on the city of Hiroshima, Japan, on August 6, 1945. The verdict in that regard is 210 votes not guilty, 34 votes guilty. As to count two, and that involves the city of Nagasaki, there are 174 votes not guilty, 70 votes guilty. Thank you for your participation. You've been great. And I'm sure all the participants thank you as well.
Well, what I was telling everybody, when this happened and Truman did, the bomb was dropped, I was 10 years old, so I remember it. You know, I'm 80 years old. So I remember when he dropped it, I didn't know there was even a controversy about it, I tell you the truth, till they asked me about this thing. I always thought everybody took it for granted he did the right thing.
I was a little surprised that the vote was as heavy for not guilty as it was, especially on Nagasaki, which is the closer question. I think the first bomb was totally militarily necessary. The second bomb, there is a good argument that can be made that we should have waited a little bit longer. But ultimately, I would have voted not guilty myself, because how much longer do you wait? You waited 3 days. It happens that after you dropped the second bomb, Japan surrendered. If you waited a week, they would not have surrendered. After you dropped the second bomb then the same argument would have been, well, you should have waited 2 months or 3 months. It's one of those things where with the Monday morning quarterbacking, you can never really kind of put yourself back in the situation. And again, I was very sincere in my closing argument. I believe that you can't fault President Truman for not knowing what he did not know. He had no idea how close Japan was to surrendering, and so he had no choice but to continue to prosecute the war and take out the targets that provided the ability for the Japanese to resist and kill Americans, and of course also suffer greater casualties themselves. I do have to, on Nagasaki, Mr. Grimm kept on arguing that the number of military stationed there was so low. That's true, but it was a weapons manufacturing center. And so when you're doing an invasion, you not only have to worry about the armed personnel against you, you got to worry about the weapons as well. And so that's why it was a valid target. And if we had a little bit more time, we would have had our witness talk about the reason that there's so many casualties is that in Nagasaki, a lot of the factory work was farmed out so that people would do it at home. And so the whole city was really one big factory with people living next to the factories. It was almost impossible to isolate a military target from a non-military target. And the other reality from my reading is that even if you did conventional bombings on the military targets, the houses were so flimsy, made of wood and paper, paper sliding doors and stuff like that, that once you hit any target in the town, the fire would have swept through the town very quickly anyway. Now after the fact, knowing that Mr. Grimm made such a thing about that, I probably would have wanted to have had a witness to come in and talk about that. But time considerations, I think we both got out the essentials on both sides.